I'm gonna have to start getting bandanas too. Right. Well, I'd be hiding the same real estate that Charlie does. Okay, Psalm 77. To the chief musicians, to Jeduthun, a psalm of Asaph. I cried out to God with my voice, to God with my voice, and he gave ear to me. In the day of my trouble, I sought the Lord. My hand was stretched out in the night without ceasing. My soul refused to be comforted. I remembered God and was troubled. I complained and my spirit was overwhelmed, Selah. You hold my eyelids open. I am troubled that I cannot speak. I have considered the days of old, the years of ancient times. I call to remembrance my song in the night. I meditate within my heart, and my spirit makes diligent search. Will the Lord cast off forever? And will he be favored no more? Has his mercy ceased forever? Has his promise failed forevermore? Has God forgotten to be gracious? Has he in anger shut up his tender mercies? Selah. And I said, this is my anguish, but I will remember the years of the right hand of the Most High. I will remember the works of the Lord. Surely I will remember your wonders of old. I will also meditate on all your work and talk of your deeds. For your way, O God, is in the sanctuary. Who is so great as our God, as our God? You are the God who does wonders. You have declared your strength among the peoples. You have, with your arm, redeemed your people, the sons of Jacob and Joseph, Selah. The waters saw you, O God, the waters saw you, they were afraid. The depths also trembled. The clouds poured out water. The skies sent out a sound. Your arrows also flashed about. The voice of your thunder was in the whirlwind. The lightnings lit up the world. The earth trembled and shook. Your way was in the sea, your path in the great waters, and your footsteps were not known. You led your people like a flock by the hand of Moses and Aaron. That's that.
That's that.
Wow. And you're 78? Okay. So I am going to open up today with a question, and it's basically, can you lose your salvation? But I'll get to that in a second. All this nonsense with Judge Kavanaugh, it's actually touched my life in strange ways that I will describe. I bicycle every day. I see these two kids who walk to the school bus every day. On Thursday, I saw them. I made the turn around the corner, heading home stretch to the house, and the little girl, who was probably six, and her brother's like six-ish or seven, she's sitting on the ground, bending over, looking at her knee, and she had fallen and tore open her leggings and also scraped her knee pretty bad. So I stopped the bike, and I go, okay, what's up? And the son had, or the brother has his cell phone out, and I said, did you call your mother? I did, but she's not answering. Plus, she's at work. I said, well, anybody else you can call? And they said, well, I'm trying to call my sister. She's at the house. And where do you live? And, well, right down that street there. It's like, and is she picking up the phone? It's like, no, she's not. I said, when does the bus come? In about 5 minutes. And so, like, you know, I helped the girl up, and she could walk. She was just, you know, a kid who scraped her knee. So I said, okay, you two walk to the bus, which is down by 41. I'm going to ride home. I'm going to get two Band-Aids, and I'm going to give them to you. And we'll go with that. So I went home. I opened the door. Linda's like, hey, how you doing? I'm like, oh, no, fine. I grab the two Band-Aids. I run back out, and I jump on the bike, and I get down, and I catch them before they get to the bus stop. So I give her the two Band-Aids, and I just say, put them on in the bus. Goodbye. And I go away. So, like, when I got back, Linda's like, where'd you go? And I said, well, I told her the story. And she goes, you didn't touch her, did you?
Oh,
and I'm like, no, I didn't. You didn't put the Band-Aid on her by chance? I said, nope. It's like, we are so afraid to be human to other humans because it might not be deemed as appropriate or stuff like that. And believe me, while I was in the midst of all that, I'm sitting there going like, okay, you know, is she usually a sissy like this? Like, you know, she's five. And like, you know, so I get her up. I'm joking around with them. Like I said, you got to watch out for those invisible snakes. They trip you up all the time. And she's chuckling and stuff. And I'm like the whole time thinking, okay, let's just make sure that this is, you know, the proper adult child thing. But it's just gotten so insane. It really has. It's going to become a point where if you shake a woman's hand inappropriately, you will go to prison. And it's just sad. So, to the topic at hand, can you lose your salvation? Who thinks they can lose their salvation? Good. Nobody. So I'm beating a dead horse with you guys. But for anybody who is concerned about that, and I'm sure there will be a few, it's said to be sealed and guaranteed. So is it sealed and guaranteed or not? So there was the inheritance of sin, which separated us from God eternally. And all that happened when after man was created, Adam sinned, and that was it. Everything fell, inclusive of us and the rest of creation. So mankind continually fell. Then suddenly we have Abraham, who believed and gained righteousness in God's eyes by believing. So we march on further through the book that we read, and law was given to his people, and the law was given for the sole reason of just condemning man of his own sin and proving that he needed a savior. So in Leviticus 18:5, keep my decrees and laws, for the person who obeys them will live by them. I am the Lord. And has anyone who has kept them lived? Well, just one person, Jesus. Okay, and then in Romans 6:23, for the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is the eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. So how does that work? And we all know this, but the words are important, and God's word is flawless. And in John 3:16-17, for God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. And then later in that same chapter, or same book, John 19:30, when he had received the drink, Jesus said, it is finished. With that, he bowed his head and gave up his spirit. So it was fulfilled. The law was obsolete. Sin is defeated. He died for all sin, potentially saving everyone, actually saving those who believe in Jesus. So what is all sin? And that's where I think where the people who feel that they can lose their salvation trip themselves up. So you'd have to ask, is it past sin? Is it present sin? Is it future sin? So if it were just past and present sin from when Jesus was on the cross, none of us would be saved because we didn't exist. We hadn't committed our sin. We did not come into life with the inherited sin from Adam. So if it was just that side of the spectrum, we're all toast. But it had to be full because we have the ability still to be saved through, as John 3:16 says, that, you know, whoever believes, just like Abraham did. So it was all sin. And then why would a sin after you truly believed in Christ cause you to lose your salvation? Now, you will lose rewards, and certainly a lot of them, if you continue in your sin path, but nonetheless, you will not lose your salvation. So what's the seal and the guarantee? 2 Corinthians 1, 21-22. Now it is God who makes both us and you stand firm in Christ. He anointed us, set his seal of ownership on us, and put his spirit in our hearts as a deposit, guaranteeing what is to come. So if God sealed and guaranteed our personal salvation, and we can lose it, as Charlie likes to say, what a crummy seal and a weak guarantee. So what about all the sins after coming to Christ? Can a believer be a crummy believer? Yes. Can a believer walk away? Yes. Can a believer be so sinful to be shunned by the body of believers and still be saved?
Listen to the sermon today. I'll answer that.
Well, it's funny. Okay, but I will put a little period on that. Hold the thought. when I was doing this middle of the week, I had no idea what was the content. I knew what you were going to be preaching on, but I didn't know the content. Uh-huh. So, like, I had this thing, like, 95%, like, nailed down. And, of course, you sent it, and I'm like going, like, okay.
That works.
So, it's funny how the Lord works. It's like, you know, here, you talk about this because he's going to talk about that. You'll find out. So, in 1 Corinthians 5, 1 through 5, and this is Paul talking to the Corinthians, it is actually reported that there is sexual immorality among you, and of a kind that even pagans do not tolerate. A man is sleeping with his father's wife, and you are proud. Shouldn't you rather have gone into mourning and have put out of your fellowship the man who has been doing this? For my part, even though I am not physically present, I am with you in spirit. As one who is present with you in this way, I have already passed judgment in the name of our Lord Jesus on the one who has been doing this. So, when you are assembled, and I am with you in spirit, and the power of the Lord is present, hand this man over to Satan for destruction of his flesh, so that his spirit may be saved on the day of the Lord. So, okay, worst sin ever, sin away. And was his flesh destroyed? Maybe after he got the boot, maybe he said, okay, this is beyond reason what I'm doing, and came back. You don't know, but it's left off with that. So he's sinned greatly. They kick him out of the church, and they let Satan do what he wants with his flesh, but so that his spirit may be saved at the day of the Lord. So if it were possible for us to lose our salvation, believe me, we'd all lose our salvation. The joy we have have in the belief of Christ is something that should also not be taken away from us. So those who believe that they can lose their salvation, I actually feel sorry for them, and I'll usually try and correct them in their thinking. And, you know, first they're fighting me tooth and nail, and I'm like, okay, well, fine. Who am I to tell you to stop thinking and worrying daily that you're going to lose your salvation? Have at it. It's like, you know, it's your joy that's diminished, not mine. So, rewards and losses, insulting our God by not living the life he has graced us with, and in disregard to his guidance and his holy word, it's solely on us. And we all want to and should strive to be as much like him as humanly possible. As with everything, it all boils down to motive. We mature in our belief and our walk by standing in his word, praising him, laying our prayers at his feet, thanking him for all he provides, both good and bad, and being a true Christian friends to our brothers and sisters. And most of all, telling the good news to anyone who'd listen. So, you cannot lose your salvation. So, Lord Jesus, thank you, Lord, for your sacrifice, your seal, and your guarantee for that simple path to salvation. And may all of us grow in your presence by studying your word and living it, and understanding what parts of it you are talking to us and what you are just teaching us in. And Lord, we just are in awe with your blessings, and pray that you be with us today in this church, and with Charlie specifically as he preaches from your word and talks more about what I just spoke about. And Lord, we just know that you're amazing and how you put the pieces together in ways that only you can. And we pray all this in your son's holy name, Jesus. Amen.